to having the five children she bears you go off to Harvard and the Sorbonne. It's just a matter of running the clock forward. I mean, these things have, I mean, to you it may seem like a miracle, but to those of us who are students of human happenstance, it's inevitable. I mean, you can launch your story. And I've, you know, in the course of taking psychedelics and looking at my life and other people's lives and narrative, I think that the secret of, I don't want to say anything as pretentious as transcendence or enlightenment, but the secret of taking hold of one's destiny is to understand that one is a character. A character is a different thing than this model you inherit out of the idea that you're a three-dimensional animal inside a democracy with a Christian heritage and, you know, a Dewey Decimal cataloging system or whatever. Anyway, these are some of the notions that occur to me in the context of comparing dream on many scales. It's, you have to really struggle, I think, to believe that you actually live inside the model of reality that science and Newtonian physics and the mathematical analysis of nature have given us. You know, not to get too philosophical here, but for positivist philosophers, everything that is important, color, feeling, taste, tone, ambition, apprehension, appetition, these things are called secondary qualities. In other words, they're peripheral. They arise at a lower level of understanding. They are somehow determined by the presence of the animal body and hence dismissible by a theory of pure abstraction, which says, you know, what is real is spin, charge, angular momentum. None of these things are very rich concepts for a living human being. Who knows what any of these things are, you know? So, we don't have time in a situation like this to explore all the implications of this dream analogy that I'm pursuing. But one that interests me is the plasticity of time in the dream. And I think I would argue, as the devil's advocate, that it is the plasticity of historical time and the acceleration, the sense of an out-of-control spin up or spin down into new domains of possibility that is the strongest evidence present at hand that we are in some kind of dream. I've struggled my whole life with, I've always believed or I've always felt the power of the statement, the world is made of language. But of course, you think about this proposition for 30 seconds, and the question that arises then is, if the world is made of language, then why isn't it the way I want it to be? You know, why does it have this prepotent momentum for its own, it has its own raison d'etre, even if it is language? Well, I think, and it's appropriate to speak of this in to an audience as digitally sophisticated as I assume you must be, I think the primary insight that has been secured here at the end of the 20th century, the primary contribution of 20th century thinking, if you will, is to have understood finally that information is primary, that this world, this cosmos, this universe, this body and soul are all made of information. Information is a deeper and more primary concept than space, time, matter, energy, charge, spin, angular momentum. The world is made of language. The implication for the digerati is that reality can therefore be hacked. If reality is made of language, then what we're saying is that it's code. And if it's code, then it is far more deeply open to manipulation than we ever dared dream. I mean, we've been messing around on the desktop, opening files with religions and political systems and xenophobic theories of racial superiority, all this crap that haunts the human historical adventure. It means we have not addressed the deeper levels. And in thinking about this and the relationship to dream and human culture, I have realized that cultures are like operating systems. We are like hardware. The human animal is a piece of biological wetware / hardware. And it has been, we know, pretty much as we confront it today for at least 140,000 years. At Classis River cave mouth in South Africa, they have excavated Homo sapiens skeletons 100,000 years old, and that person could have sat in the front row here tonight and nobody would have batted an eyebrow. So the human hardware has been in place for a while. What has changed rapidly in comparison to the rates of biological evolution are the operating systems. The people who excavated Ur, which was at that time thought to be the world's first city, and in any case is a city 7 millennia old, when they excavated the central plaza at Ur, they discovered that a black basaltic slab had been set up there by the earliest kings of Ur, and that was the cultural operating system. And if in a deal trading goats for olives, a dispute arose, people had reference to the central operating system, and these things were determined. Well, now, Ur 101 was fine for olives and goat trading, but it didn't support higher mathematics, it didn't support rational exploration of nature, it didn't support astrological knowledge about the movement of the stars. As we have gone forward through culture, we have swapped out these operating systems. And at each swap out, there has been a lot of hair pulling and cussing and screaming. Anyone who has installed a new operating system is completely familiar with that sickening from the bowels kind of coldness, as you know, you realize it all hangs by a thread. Now, this situation, or this operating system metaphor, I think is a useful one for understanding, and again, a circle closes, the balkanization of epistemology that causes me such anxiety. If you meet an Aboriginal person from the Amazon, for example, they may be running Witoto 3.0 as their operating system. Nicely supports animistic magic, huge capacity when it comes to making fish traps and bird traps. Witoto is a powerful operating system for a rainforest Aboriginal. In our culture, You know, there are, I have no idea, at least 10 or 20 operating systems all going at the same time. Some